Blackstone presents Old Jules by Mari Sandoz. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki, with an introduction read by Roxanne Hernandez, and a foreword read by Gabrielle de Cuir, directed by Cassandra de Cuir.
Old Jules and the Maggots of Society. You know I consider writers and artists the maggots of society. Jules Sandoz to Mari Sandoz, 1926. Once, when a poet friend visited me on the ranch, we naturally talked about our writing. Visiting with my parents, we chatted at length about the importance of writers in society. Finally, my friend said, "It's hard work sitting under a tree writing a poem." I remember bracing myself for a viciously sarcastic remark from my father, but I can no longer remember what he said. For years afterward, however, he sneered as he quoted my friend's remark to laughing neighbors. Many of those hardworking ranchers believed attending college, reading books, or creating art was a luxury no working family could afford. They proudly said they hadn't read a book since grade school. My father always remembered my friend's name, and every year or so asked about her. I'd answer honestly. She'd won a National Endowment for the Arts grant. She'd published a book. He'd grimace and say, "So she's living off the government. Has she got a job? Is she married? Or is she still looking for a man?" No matter what I said, he'd add, "Maybe she ought to spend less time sitting under trees writing poetry." When I announced she'd gotten married and started having children, he smirked. "Once she starts having babies, she'll be too busy changing diapers to sit under a tree and write poetry. She's going to find out what real work is." And every time we spoke about her, he'd conclude, "You know, old Jules had it right when he said writers and artists are the maggots of society." In Mary's words, "People who are disturbed by old Jules forget that only the strong and the ruthless stayed, that the squeamish may be nicer to live with, but they conquer no wilderness. If you look into history, you will find that vision is always accompanied by a degree of thoughtlessness, impatience, and even intolerance for others." Maggots, legless, soft-bodied, worm-like fly larvae, develop quickly in dead flesh and become annoying houseflies and bluebottles. Most rural children could tell firsthand maggot stories, so Jules used familiar facts for his insulting metaphor. Yet both Jules and my father, John, taught their daughters how to make wise decisions about the land and animals that were our responsibility. The way our fathers treated us contradicted that degrading judgment. Jules's daughter worked hard to become a respected writer and historian. She never willingly compromised her own high standards, never backed down from a battle with anyone who disagreed with her. She survived blizzards, prairie fires, an apartment house fire, rattlesnakes, argumentative editors, critics, bad reviews, death threats, and every crisis in her life but the last. Nearing the end of her fight to snatch more writing time from the cancer that was killing her, she wrote briskly and without pretense, "After two malignancies, one learns to be prepared for anything and promises very little for the future. If I'm alive, I'll be happy to write the introduction for the book." She finished the introduction, though it was published posthumously. Anything but soft-bodied, that Mary. As Mary contemplated and quoted her father's remark about the maggots in later years, I wonder if she thought of that epic story of the trapper Hugh Glass, left to die on the Dakota prairie by his so-called friends after being clawed by a grizzly. She knew Frederick Manfred, apparently admired his writing, and doubtless read Lord Grizzly, his fictionalized account of the ordeal. As Manfred tells it, Glass crawled toward civilization in the stench of his own decaying flesh as the wounds on his back began to rot. Maggots ate the putrid meat, so by the time Glass could stand upright and think of revenge, his back had healed. The maggots clearly did him more good than harm. Moreover, maggots transform themselves. They change from wiggling.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.